First of all, I want to thank you very much. I actually arrived like 4 minutes ago, and they were so chill, like, you know, un-British, quite un-British. Thank you so much. I have no idea what my slides will look like. And so please forgive me if the slides go out of order or anything doesn't work. You know, it's not about the slides. My moonshot for the next 20 minutes is to make 180 people happy. Okay, so I have to disguise this somehow into happiness at work, but seriously, who cares about work? Anyway, the idea is if I can manage to make you happy, I think you're gonna make everyone happy at work, right? And that's actually my first, so I call my presentation the 10 rules of happiness at work. We're not gonna go through all 10, I hope to go through 5 of them. The first of them is what they tell you on airplanes. Do you know that idea of attend to yourself first before you help others? Right? And the truth of the matter is that I had the pleasure of working at Google, which I believe has won for many, many years the Best Place to Work For award. It was, when I joined, it was definitely the happiest place to work for, but that's sort of somehow changed across parts of Google. And I sometimes had grumpy, very serious colleagues come to me and say, we need to make people happy, right? If you're grumpy, you're not gonna make anyone happy. And that's a very simple rule. Huh? As a matter of fact, if you wanna make anyone happy and you're in HR, for example, and the top leader doesn't want to make people happy, it's a hopeless case, okay? So the whole idea is attend to yourself first before you help others, which makes for the first rule, be a happy leader. I also say that at home, if you're raising children, remember that if we raise children who are highly successful in life but miserable, we failed, okay? And so if you want to be a good parent, which is the ultimate form of leader, be a happy parent. Make happiness your priority and make that work for you so that it works for them. Rule number two comes with one little observation on the screen, which I would ask you to find what's common across all of those wonderful characters that you can see here. Everyone's smiling. Every child you have ever met in your life. Did that work well? Okay, let's do that again. Do you like this? So every child you ever met in your life, if they were fed and safe and given their basic needs for survival, their state was happy. Okay? No child at those early ages asked for an Xbox to be happy or wanted, I didn't do that, I swear, or wanted someone to like their butt shot on Instagram to feel happy. Huh? When we're children, all we really need is to be given our basic needs for survival. Surprisingly, however, I would almost guarantee that everyone in this room has their basic needs of survival met, yet we manage to somehow find a lot of reasons to be unhappy, okay? I'll come to the reasons why, but for a minute, I want you to remember that gamification works. And if Google ever succeeded at anything, the early Google was such a fun place to be. So people thought that we were having fun to go through the slides that were on the internet and going to the game rooms. The fun was actually in the meeting rooms. The fun was in the, when we were writing the code, when we were doing things that we actually really enjoyed. And, believe it or not, if you make work fun, you may not have to worry that much about policies and HR policies and salaries and so on. And making work fun is simply a mindset. It's not really a policy at all. And so making work fun is my second rule. I'm running through those quickly. I just want you I'll start from here about your own happiness. Any Supertramp fans in the audience? You're showing your age, come put your hands down. Actually, there are young Supertramp fans, that's amazing. Anyone who doesn't know the Logical Song, I think you should download the Logical Song because the Logical Song summarizes our story, every single one of us, our story of moving from that happy baby to who we are right now in 40 seconds. And here is how it goes. Thank you. My animations didn't work as intended. I apologize. But did you hear the lyrics? So I normally have the lyrics for those who are non-English speakers, which I consider London to be. But anyway, so the idea is, you, when you were young, life seemed to be so wonderful. Everything was happy. You know, whatever happened, you had a toy, you didn't have a toy, you were happy. And then there was that day. Remember that day when they sent you to school? Okay? They just simply said, you know, that playful, joyful, happy person, no more. Okay? You need to be serious. I'm like six. What's serious? Right? But we all comply. And what happens truly is exactly what happens to your mobile phone. You buy a mobile phone, it works perfectly well as a child the first day. The second day, it starts to mess up massively. The battery lasts 4 hours and you have to charge three times a day. Right? The reason is not because there is anything wrong with your mobile phone. It's because you start to install weird apps on it. Okay? And those apps, by the way, are doing exactly what they're intended to do. Huh? Instagram is supposed to report what everyone's eating around the world, and you're supposed to like that crap, right? And so you do it. But as you do that, you're switching the phone on, you're switching the screen on, and that's basically eating your battery life. Nothing wrong with the phone, nothing wrong with the app. Mix them together, and everything messes up. This is exactly our history. You are born happy, you're perfectly in that, you know, that optimum mode of performance, which is healthy and happy, and then they install weird apps. Some of those apps will take you very, very, very far. Huh? The shape of your body matters, you have to fit in, money is more important than happiness, success is more important than happiness, and all of that stuff. So I normally try to show our state of happiness this way. I say that the happy you is simply covered with obligations, societal expectations, false beliefs, and those are the reasons for your happiness. Now, take a look back at that little child and you'll understand the secret. The secret is that what Cosmopolitan magazine tells you, the seven things you can do to be happy, is not true at all. Okay? The truth is there is nothing you can do to be happy. There is only one thing you should do, which is to stop being unhappy. Okay? Look back at that child. When a diaper gets wet, the child cries. There is a reason for unhappiness that makes the child cry. You change the diaper, you remove the reason, the child goes back to happiness. And that's absolutely true for every one of us, including every one of our employees, including every one of us here in the room. Okay? The reality is, if there is no reason for unhappiness, our default state is happy. But in a highly consumerist world, they tell us that we should go out of ourselves and seek happiness outside. Go partying on Friday night, or go to a vacation, or go buy an expensive car, or whatever that is. And none of that works, because it's like searching for your glasses when you're already wearing them. Okay? It's basically looking everywhere for something that you already have. It's looking for happiness outside you when happiness is actually inside you. So just quickly to say, how did we do that at Google? When we were to make our employees happy, we actually didn't, it wasn't about the sushi and the game rooms. It was about removing the reasons for unhappiness. Okay? When the employees complained about the commute from San Francisco to Mountain View, we didn't just shut them up with an allowance. We created a commute, you know, buses for them to sit on in a nice way, in a social way, where they have Wi-Fi, they can work, they can interact with their families, they can do whatever it is that they want. So that's my rule number three. Rule number four is to be understood in a very simple experiment. And the experiment, actually, I would ask every one of you, hopefully, if you don't mind me giving you homework, when you go home today, do this. Write something that I call the happy list. And the happy list is a list of things that make you happy. Okay? I don't know if you've ever done this before. It actually surprises me a lot that everyone I meet will tell me, and I ask them, do you want to be happy? They say, of course I want to be happy. And I say, so do you know what makes you happy? And they go like, yeah. Like, I have a list, 92 items on my list, where I know for certain exactly what the things that make me happy are. Okay, so on my, you know, on my own, so it's basically the answer of I feel happy when. I feel happy when I have a good cup of coffee. I feel happy when my daughter smiles. I feel happy when I learn. I feel happy when I'm the company of wonderful people like you. Okay, now when you know those things, two amazing things happen. One is suddenly you realize that happiness is not that difficult. A good cup of coffee, I have three a day. So what? right? I feel happy when my daughter smiles. I always send her dirty jokes, okay? And I'm not joking. I mean, my daughter's 24, so, you know, I'm past that stage where I'm raising her, she's raising me. But anyway, so the trick is very straightforward, huh? If you know what makes you happy, you'll invite it in your life a little more often, okay? Which reminds me of one really, really important topic to bring up. If you don't blame life for unhappiness. If you can have access to happiness in simple things and you don't bring them into your life, then maybe you should ask yourself, why am I not doing this, right? So your happy list will also serve you with one interesting observation, and that observation simply is, no one has ever, I did this more than 20,000 times, no one has ever written on their happy list, I feel happy when I buy a Ferrari. Okay? Nobody has ever written, I feel happy when I win the Nobel Prize, I feel happy when I get a promotion. All of that crap, all of the illusions they fill our minds with, they never feature on the happy list. Okay? We just chase them and feel unhappy when we have them. When we get them, we feel happy for 2.5 minutes, a day, maybe three. Okay? And every HR person in this audience will know that you promote an employee, 3 days later, they'll come back and complain about something else. Right? And the truth is, if you know your happy list, you can do what I did with it. The reason I did this exercise as an engineer researching the topic of happiness was trying to find a definition for happiness. And I was literally trying to find a fitting line between all of the points in my life where I ever felt happy. And you know what that fitting line looks like? It basically is, I feel happy when life seems to be going my way. Okay? No event in your life has ever made you happy or unhappy. No event at work has ever made you happy or unhappy. I've had many, many managers in my life, many of them, all were crap. Okay? I always say one of them was an incredible manager and the others were horrible. That always leaves them guessing. Okay? All of them want to know which one it is.
What is the X and Y here?
I'll come to that in a minute. Mathematicians will always ask what the X and Y are, right? But by the way, it never made me unhappy to have a horrible manager because I expected managers to be horrible. Do you understand that? It's what we're made for. To be a manager, you have to be horrible, right? This is, you know, reality of life. And so I feel happy when life seems to be going my way can be translated visually this way. If the events of life miss your expectations, you're unhappy. If the events of life meet your expectations, you're happy. And that can be summarized in a very simple equation. Your happiness is equal to or greater than the events of your life minus your expectations of how life should behave. Now, this also is the happiness equation of your employees. Basically, what they're doing all the time is they're comparing the events of the company to their expectations of how the company should be run. If that meets their expectations, they're happy. If it misses their expectations, they feel unhappy. Now, remember, my task here, my moonshot, is to make 180 people happy, not 180 million. Hopefully, you'll help me get to 180 million. So I want to remind you of this. Every moment in your life you ever felt unhappy was the result of your brain engaging in a survival mechanism that's called unhappiness. It was trying to alert you that something around you is not working well. So your boyfriend comes home with 4 hairs in his ear. Okay? He could be getting you flowers, hugging you, loving you, but the 4 hairs. The 4 hairs. That means he doesn't like me anymore. Okay? And once that event misses your expectations, you're unhappy. Okay. Now, with that in mind, the biggest thing we've done at Google that really, really, really changed everything was transparency. So, if you know, at least my Google, everyone had access to all information all the time. Nothing was hidden. I never stood on a stage in front of people and said things like, the purpose of this company is blah, 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 and our biggest assets is people. When we screwed up, we stood up and said we screwed up. Okay? And believe it or not, that made people happier. It made them happier because it made them understand that what you see is what you get, that the truth is out there, and that we're all responsible for it together. Okay? Now, I go back to you as people. If an event misses your expectations, look for what is the reality of the event and how realistic is your expectation, because if you can fix the balance between those, you'll be fine. And if you don't mind me saying, I'm a Middle Eastern, so I come from a highly, highly traumatized area of the world, at least for the last many years. If you're British or you live in London, you're probably one of the luckiest 1% of the whole world. Okay? So the events should probably meet your expectations. Okay? Even if you're in the underground and it's you call it the subway. Yeah, that actually is a sandwich in America. But, you know, so if even if you're in the tubes, you call it the tubes. Yeah, that's plumbing in America. So if you're, you know, if you're in the tubes, huh, and it's late and it's busy, at least you're not walking 25 miles to work like they do in Kenya. Okay? And if you see the reality of the events minus the expectations, that will always work. Now, the question why it is that we feel unhappy when our life is so blessed as compared to 7 other billion people in the world is to be found in a simple exercise that I will close with. In that exercise, I'll ask you to do 2 things at the same time. I call it the blank brain test. The first thing I will ask you to do is to close your eyes and think of something that makes you unhappy. I guarantee you your brain will not hesitate for a second. It's like, hey, bring me something that makes me unhappy. Seriously? I have 16 I've been waiting to tell you about. So I'm going to ask you to do that for 20 seconds. When you find that unhappy feeling inside you, I'm going to ask you to open your eyes, look at the screen, and add simple arithmetics. Just add the numbers as they appear on the screen. Okay? Success at the end of the exercise is to stay unhappy and add the numbers. Can you do that? Okay, so let's start. Close your eyes, please. Take 20 seconds, think of something that makes you unhappy. Okay, now keep that happy feeling inside, really reflect on it. Try to stay unhappy. Now please open your eyes and add the numbers. Oh my God, you're supposed to stay unhappy. At least add the numbers now if you want. Okay, so these are not difficult if you know how to add them, but anyway. So I only had one engineer at Google only once come at two numbers close to 15, 19. But the purpose of this exercise is not to test your math skills. Huh? The purpose of this exercise is what we in engineering call a full cycle simulation. Okay? So if you notice, before I asked you to do this test, everyone was okay. No one was grumpy, no one was looking at me strange. Everyone seemed to be okay. Okay, oops. Animations. All right. I'll just use it as it is. Huh? So I took you through what we call a full cycle simulation. It took you from happy to unhappy and happy again in the course of literally 20 seconds. Okay. At T0, you seem to be okay. At T1, I asked you to close your eyes and think of something that makes you unhappy. At T2, I showed you a few numbers on the screens and you laughed. Interesting, huh? So we can generate that feeling on demand, really. And how do we generate it on demand? With 2 questions, you will understand how the machine works. Question number 1 is, did anything happen in the real world between T0 and T1? When I asked you to close your eyes and you remembered the 4 hairs in your boyfriend's ear, okay? Did they just pop out of his ear at that moment in T1? Or were they always there? Okay? They were always there. If I asked you to remember, to think of something that made you unhappy, you said, my manager is an idiot. Did he just suddenly become an idiot, or was he always an idiot? Okay? The truth is, nothing happens in the real world that triggers our unhappiness. Actually, what happens is, the only thing that happens is, you start thinking. You start thinking, right? The minute you start thinking, unhappiness comes in. I showed you a few numbers on the screen. All I did really was I distracted you, so you stopped thinking. And you know what happened? Immediately, you became happy again. Okay? It's the thought that makes you unhappy. It's not the events of life. No event has ever been given the power to make you unhappy until you turned it into a thought and turned it into your head over and over and over to torture yourself. Question number 2 is even more important. If I kept you unhappy, by the way, for 6 seconds, not 20. I couldn't do it in my heart. Huh? 6 seconds. If I had asked you to stay unhappy for 6 hours, do you think your boyfriend would have suddenly shown up and said, hey, I groomed? Okay? Would your manager suddenly pop up and say, I'm so sorry, I'm not supposed to be an idiot? Nothing changes in the real world as a result of unhappiness. Do you realize that? Nothing. You can stay unhappy. Ooh, I'm done with time. Events miss my expectations. Okay. And now I don't know how to stop it. All right. This is the last slide. So, nothing happens in the real world as a result of unhappiness. This unhappiness thing is the most stupid process humanity has ever invented. It's triggered by nothing, because no event actually takes place. You just do Netflix, right? It's unhappiness on demand. You say your brain just regenerates an event from last Friday. It happened last Friday, it's over. Or worries about an event next Friday. And it leads to nothing. It leads to nothing. You can stay unhappy for the rest of your life. I wrote Soul for Happy because I lost my son. I lost him due to a very negligent human error in a very simple medical operation. Okay? I could have closed my door and cried for 27 years. It wouldn't have brought him back. Do you realize that? The only thing that would have happened is I would have cried for 27 years. So if you start to realize that, what it basically means is that happiness is a choice. Because you know what? In the situation of four hairs in his ear, if you think about it all the way on your commute to work and then your boss says, forget about whatever is bothering you, I want the report I asked for, you tell your brain, hey brain, can you please think about the report, we'll think about the hairs later, and your brain complies. The question truly is, why is it that when it becomes a time for unhappiness, that we actually don't let that happen to our brain? We don't tell our brain enough brain. And if you think about that, I'm not going to give you the answer. Huh? There seems to be a utility to happiness in our modern society, to unhappiness in our modern society. We seem to believe that it's good for us to be unhappy. Once you see through that illusion, happiness will set in. Okay? Once you decide that it's not okay to be unhappy, that just like with health, it's not okay to catch the flu. When I feel that I'm catching the flu, I do something about it. Okay? You will fix it. I have every video, like you kindly said, I have 10 hours of lectures in Stanford University online. Read if you like to. Read His Holiness the Dalai Lama, you know, Sean Aker, whoever you want. But if you decide that happiness is your priority, trust me, it's just like fitness. With neuroplasticity, if you invest an hour a day, four times a week, just like going to the gym, I promise you in 21 days you'll be happier. And it doesn't matter what the method is, it's as engineered as everything else you've ever done. So I'll stop with that, take questions if you want to, or...